there was a retro challenge back in 2014 where, well, it's a challenge to do something retro computery. So I decided to convert the breadboard Z80 onto PCBs and labelled it all up RC2014 because that was what it was about.
The retro challenge special.
Yes, yes.
Good stuff. So can you take us through it? What did it do? How did it work? All that sort of stuff.
Yep. Okay. Well, if you've seen the previous video, it's pretty much the same kind of thing. You've still got the same Z80 processor, 32K of RAM, 8K of ROM, Microsoft Basic on it. You communicate with it primarily over serial, and yeah, it can run any basic programs effectively.
It sounds like you've had a lot of fun in building this thing, but I mean, why wouldn't you go out and say just buy a Raspberry Pi or some kind of Arduino setup?
Where's the fun in that? Where's the fun? This is much more back to the roots. This is. If you was going to build a computer back in late 70s, early 80s, you would have bought the components, you would have soldered the circuit boards together, you would have built it up from scratch from there. So it's more a nod back to the past than necessarily the future, like the Pi or the Arduinos.
And Joe, just point at some of the bits you might have to solder for the uninitiated.
Yeah, actually, what I'll do, disconnect it and just pull out all the modules. Each of the chip sockets has to be soldered onto the PCB, all of the header pins, ones which got discrete components like the resistors and the crystals need to be soldered on, and the headers onto the back plane and other trivial stuff. There is a lot to be soldered on the back there. One of my best. Yeah, it's not bad. The record for building one of these at the moment is an hour and a half.
So that's a challenge there, isn't it?
That's from unpacking the kit, getting out your soldering iron, hour and a half later, yeah, up and running.
Take us through what it used to be like trying to do a new program on a computer or borrowing someone's code.
Well, prior to GitHub, if you was lucky, you had a computer where there was a magazine for it. So every month you go down to the newsagents, get your magazine and read through all the comments and all the listings in there so you could actually type in the programs from scratch from the magazine. Failing that, if you was a bit more niche, there was a lot of mail groups, which was literally post off the information. So yeah, you'd receive a package in the post, unpack it all, and yeah, you can type in your program from there, or you might even get a floppy disk in the post.
Presumably, if you've built your own computer, it's down to you then. How do you get stuff to work on that?
A lot of programs can be adapted to run on this because it runs Microsoft Basic. There's a lot of basic programs out there. And yeah, it's fairly straightforward to get those converted across. There's a growing community now with the RC2014. They're also adding in their own bits of software, like the Fractal programs from Nils there. Which is all being shared on GitHub, ironically. So that's the way it's done these days.
So cut and paste rather than typing out character by character.
That's right. Yes. If you still want to do the typing character by character, you can do. The key thing which I decided to do with this was modularise everything into its own individual basic component, and it all runs on a passive backplane. The backplane does nothing other than join the parts together.
So it's a bit like a more complicated breadboard then, really?
Essentially, yes. If we start from the left-hand side, we've got the clock module, so that generates the clock signal that runs the timing of everything there. Next to that, we've got the CPU. That's a Z80 CPU, running at 7.6 megahertz on this one, because that's what the clock's running at. Next to that, we've got the ROM, which has got Microsoft Basic burnt onto it. After the ROM, we've got 32K of RAM. It is possible to double up on those if you want 64K of RAM. Quite what you do with that amount of space, no idea. 64K is ridiculously large.
Can you put that in perspective? How much space does a program take up today to do, say, what's going on behind you?
The program for that is probably 1K, maybe 1.5K. Yeah, it is very, very small. And then on the right-hand side is the communication. That's the serial adapter there. This one here, I've got it connected to an FTDI lead, so that is a USB to serial lead. Because it speaks serial, there's so many things out there which also speak serial, like Arduinos, like Raspberry Pis. It's the universal language, so anything with a serial port can connect in and control it. It is very, very easy to get into. As long as you know which end of a soldering iron to hold, you can build one of these. They are quite straightforward. It's all nice and easy to solder stuff, so there's no complicated, tricky surface mountings or anything like that. It's all simple through hole. So yeah, building it up is actually quite straightforward. As long as you can plug it into a serial port, you're good to go. There's a whole bunch of terminal emulation programs out there. You know, things like PuTTY or a TerraTerm, which you can use to talk through your computer serial port.
Okay, and then you just connect to it and then you can start programming, can you?
Exactly, yes. Yeah, as soon as you turn the power on, it's ready to go. You know, 10 print computer file is cool, 20 go to 10.
Like it.
We'd like to thank Audible.com for sponsoring this episode of Computerphile. And Audible are offering our viewers, that's you guys, a free audiobook and a 30-day free trial if you go to audible.com/computerphile, this link here. You'll have to use a desktop device to go up and sign up, and then after that use a mobile device to view what they've got to offer and obviously listen to the books. Today I'd like to recommend Creativity Inc. by Ed Catmull. Ed Catmull's one of the co-founders of Pixar, and he talks all about how Pixar go about making movies and how he was kind of deflated after they had their first success, and that's all about him kind of reaching his goal. So he talks a little bit about one or two of the important ingredients that Pixar have, and of course, remember, they were the ones who came out with the first feature film to be fully animated on a computer, so there's a Computerphile angle there. Thanks once again to Audible for sponsoring this episode of Computerphile.
Quite a tactile thing to be doing, that, pushing those in.
It's very, very satisfying.
Therapeutic.
Yes. Would you like a go?
Yes, absolutely.